Well, hi, everybody. Thanks for coming. My name is Warren Davis, largely known as the creator of the video game Qbert. Thank you so much. So what I was going to talk about Qbert, of course. I have so many stories from my career, and Qbert was really the very beginning of my career. And honestly, it almost seems like it's one of the least interesting stories to tell. I'm happy to tell, and I'm happy to answer any questions. So I'm prepared to talk about Qbert because that's what they asked me to talk about mostly when I was here. I'm going to talk a little bit about some other stuff as well, and I think I'm going to keep it kind of loose. I've got some like notes and stuff prepared, but I think I'm just going to keep it kind of loose, and I'll definitely leave room for questions. And it's such a small group here. I'd just say throw a question, throw your hand up if you have a question as we go along. And I think that'll work out just fine. So what you see up here is a business card. And this was my first business card when I got in the industry. The thing that's really interesting is the address, 759 Industrial Drive. And that's interesting because this Bensonville location was separate from Gottlieb's main plant. Gottlieb, as you may or may not know, was a pinball manufacturer from the 1920s, family-owned business. In the mid-1970s, it was sold to Columbia Pictures, as it says over there. And it was no longer a family business, but they were a pinball company from way back, along with Bally and Williams and Stern and a bunch of others. But they were new to video games in the early 1980s. I started working there in January of 1982. It's kind of an interesting story. I will tell you the story about how I came to work there. You may have heard this somewhere, but I was unemployed. I had worked for Bell Laboratories in Naperville, Illinois. That's what brought me to Illinois. And I really wasn't enjoying being an engineer. I had a master's degree in electrical engineering. But I really wasn't enjoying it, and I decided to move to Chicago to become an actor. And I started studying improv at Second City and doing that, but I was unemployed. And I was living off the money I made for Bell Laboratories. And so what I would do is, in the Sunday Chicago Tribune, they had want ads, and I would sort of secretly look at the engineering want ads. What the hell? Maybe they'll see something I like. Strangely enough, lo and behold, I saw an ad in the Sunday paper for video game programmers. Now, I wasn't much enjoying working at Bell Laboratories because it was not what I would call a creative environment. It was more of a corporate environment. When I saw, I always thought video game programmer was like the dream job. So I actually wrote a little letter and sent a resume off to Gottlieb. It was around Christmas time of 1981. I got an answer back for an interview like 2 days later, and a week just right after New Year's, I came in for an interview. And it was an interesting interview because I had this attitude about me. It's like, I don't want to go back to an engineering job. I want to do something, that's kind of loose and fun. And so I went into this with a little bit of an attitude of, look, if they don't like me, that's too bad. I could easily not accept this. And then I met a bunch of people, and they showed me around, and some of the people were really cool, I thought were great. Some of the people were kind of like those engineers that I had left at Bell Labs and I wasn't interested in. And it seems ridiculous when I think about it now, but I actually wrestled with the idea of whether or not to take this job, which turned out to be like an amazing dream job. But I did take it, and one encounter I had in the interview was with the VP of engineering. His name is Ron Waxman, who kind of has become a classic figure, but he was a classic figure. He was a very large, very round man, had a little goatee, and he was very gruff. He would just stare at you and he had no expression on his face. And when I went in to interview him, he just sat and he would look at me and stare me down. And he would say, "Why do you think you can be a video game programmer?" And I would say, "I don't know, I've never done it before. You're right." There you go. Do you have a computer at home? This is 1982, so there, you know, the IBM PC just come out. And I said, no, I don't have a computer at home. I use them at work. You know, so but I thought he hated me. I mean, every question he asked me had an attitude. I found out later that was just a thing he did. He was actually a pussycat, but that was just a thing he did to people, just to see if he could rile them or something. Anyway, so I came here to Bensonville, where it was very much of a think tank environment. There were no, like I said, the main plant where they did all the pinball development and manufacturing was in Northlake. And we were a separate group, because the video game group was pretty new. Gottlieb had licensed a couple of games from a Japanese company, but actually when I was hired, they were just about to release their first in-house game. It was called Reactor. And Tim Skelly was the guy who did it. He programmed it. And Tim Skelly was kind of like the superstar at the time. He had done a bunch of games for Cinematronics, and he was very well known. And he came in, he became kind of like the guru and the mentor to those of us who were, you know, just starting out. And I certainly didn't know anything about making a video game. I had never done it before. So the first thing they put me on was another guy's game. I was actually helping out some other programmer. And he was a self-taught programmer. He had never made a game before. And he was doing a game that was kind of based on the Superman movie, Superman 2. You know, Superman was fighting the three Kryptonian villains. Now, we didn't have the license to put Superman up there, so it was just some random superhero who could fly, and three random villains who could fly, and he was punching them out, and they would go flying into buildings. Now, these are 1982 graphics, so that, you know, characters like 7 pixels tall. It's kind of amazing that you could get, you know, personality into them, and that's really a tribute to Jeff Lee, who is our artist, and who later became the artist for Cuban. But it was, you know, it was an interesting game. It didn't really go anywhere. My contribution was, so these Kryptonian, sorry, they weren't Kryptonian. These villains were, you know, Superman was punching, not Superman, sorry, the hero, was knocking them into buildings, and rubble would fall onto the pedestrians who were walking back and forth on the bottom of the screen. And I programmed a bulldozer that kind of came out and pushed the rubble off the screen. So that's how the rubble went away. I guess, you know, it wasn't, we hadn't thought of just making the rubble disappear. Like, in later games, you shoot somebody and their body just kind of disappears. But the rubble couldn't just disappear. Actually, a bulldozer came out and pushed it off screen. That was me. This game was never released. It went out on test a number of different ways. It had all these different names. We did it with a joystick with a trackball. At one point, we made the hero look like Ron Waxman, the VP of engineering. He was this big round guy flying. It didn't fly. But I learned the basics of making a video game. And then when that project was sort of scrapped, then it was basically up to me to make a video game of my own. Now, I still felt like I needed to learn some things. All I did was make a bulldozer come out. And one day I saw another programmer, his name is Kan Yamamoto, and he's known for programming the game called Mad Planets, if any of you are aficionados. And Kan was experimenting with foreground and background planes, because our hardware allowed you to have separate foreground and background planes. But he was doing this thing, our hardware actually let you swap the foreground and background, which is, by the way, something that Qbert uses. When Qbert jumps off the pyramid, I actually do a bit flip, and that's how he falls behind the pyramid, because Qbert is foreground and the pyramid is background. Anyway, a little technical thing. But he was experimenting with something else. He had a pattern filling the screen, and he was sort of experimenting with removing pieces of this background, which was set to the foreground, so you could reveal what was behind it. And this pattern he had covering the screen was like an M.C. Escher pattern. That was actually made of little hexagons, but they were shaded so that they looked like cubes. And when I looked at that, I thought, well, that's interesting, because if you made a pyramid out of those cubes and something fell on the top, it would have one of two ways to go. Every time it landed, it would have one of two ways to go. That's binary. And to me, I just thought, okay, here's an exercise. I could teach myself randomness, picking a random path, and gravity, something's falling. So I took that artwork, I turned it into a pyramid, and I had Jeff Lee, our artist, make me a little ball, a little round ball, something simple, and I programmed a ball jumping down a pyramid of cubes. And people looked at it and they were like, wow, that's kind of cool, it looks kind of interesting. And it did, it had an interesting look. Well, okay, what's the next step? Put a player character up there and have him jump around. So that's what I did next. I went to Jeff and I said, you know, you got a player character or somebody, some character I can use? And he had made all these characters, he just had them lying around for something else he was thinking. And I picked the orange guy with the long nose. Jeff had created him that way because he envisioned a game in which he would shoot stuff out of his nose. I didn't really want that or need that for what I was doing, he said, yeah, sure, take him. I should say also that at Gottlieb, the philosophy at Gottlieb is that the programmers were the ones who were the project leaders, the programmers as opposed to the artists. Because when I went to Williams later in my career, Williams was kind of the reverse. A lot of times the artists were in charge and the programmers just took direction. But at Gottlieb, the programmers were considered the project leaders. So, and Jeff was kind of like the floater. I don't even think, for a long time, I don't think we had another artist. He just basically did everything for everybody. So Jeff gave me these characters. I had the guy jumping around, and we were off and running. And that's kind of how Q-Bert began. People liked the way it looked. They thought, you know, it was interesting. And then it became, okay, well, what's next? What's next? So Q-Bert was very much an evolutionary game in that every element of it sort of came in one at a time. Sorry, here, let me refresh that. Yeah. And people would come to me with ideas. You know, the thing that really made it a game was there was one night, so I had Q-Bert, he's jumping around the pyramid, and Ron Waxman, he had this habit of sort of sitting behind people at night. So it's like a late night. It's like 7, 8 o'clock. I'm still there. Waxman is just sitting behind me. I hear him breathing. I mean, I hear him breathing. And I'm doing my work, and I'm just kind of tuning him out. And at one point he goes, what if the top of the cubes change color when he lands on them? Wow. That sounds like a good idea. So I did that, and then suddenly the game had a point and a purpose. And it was kind of like that all the way around. So, you know, a lot of people, and it has been written in some places, say that Q-Bert was developed by committee. That's actually not true at all. A lot of people came to me with ideas. A lot of those ideas, I said no. You know, Jeff Lee thought Q-Bert should shoot out of his nose. No, it just didn't work, and also it made the physics very complicated. I do think it was Jeff's idea to have Ugg and Wrongly come in at different angles, and I kind of resisted that because I was like, you know, and that just drove me crazy as far as how do I program that? How do I, you know, this was basically, we didn't have 3D graphics the way we do. This was all pseudo 3D. And collision detection and blah, 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 but I took it as a challenge and I said, okay, let me try it. And so we actually did put that in. And all the rest of the elements sort of just happened that way. The discs, you know, and again, to be honest, I couldn't even tell you who came up with what because people were just throwing things at me. So, you know, things were mine, things were Jeff's, things were other people's. But there were a lot of bad ideas. I mean, there were a lot of bad ideas. One terrible idea happened with the naming of the game, because I didn't have a name for the game, I didn't have a name for the character, and everybody kind of decided, well, we should name, the name of the game should be the name of the character. So, I went around to everybody that worked at Gottlieb and I said, well, what do you think we should name it? And I had a list of about, you know, 50 ideas. And the only one that sticks out that I just hated was Arnie Aardvark. Somebody was like, what'd you call it Arnie Aardvark? No, I don't think so. The way we did name it Q-Bert was kind of weird. We had a meeting one day, and this was when the game was pretty much done. It had been out on test. Our vice president of marketing, Howie Rubin. Now, Howie was also an interesting guy. So Ron and Howie were kind of like the guys that ran the department. Howie was the kind of guy that would run into our little room where we worked. It was actually a big room. We didn't have individual offices. We all worked in like one big room. And he would say, all right, stop working. And he would take us out into the plant, because at Bensonville, the plant was completely empty. We were not manufacturing anything at that point. He would say, come on out, and he would make us play football in the plant. Big, massive room that's not being used for anything. Eventually, it did get used, but at the time, for months, it was, again, we were kind of a new group. And that's the kind of guy Howie was. Well, Howie wanted the name of the game to be the cartoon balloon. When Q-Bert dies. And we're like, how is that going to work? I mean, what are people going to call it? And he's like, if people want, they'll find a way. If people like the game, they'll find a way. And a lot of us were like, God, that's a terrible idea. But he insisted, and the game actually went out on test with the cartoon balloon as a marquee. And some of those marquees are still around. In fact, I think people are printing new ones. So if you buy them nowadays, I don't know if you can get, you're getting an original or a copy, but there are some of those. But then he thought better of it, and then we realized we had to name it. And we may have, actually, I think we named it before he put it out with the cartoon balloon. But then we had a meeting. We had like a dozen people, me and Jeff. I'm not sure if Dave Thiel was there. Certainly Howie and Ron, Rich Tracy, who was the art director for the company, and a bunch of people just sitting around talking about what we should name this character. And at one point, I had to sit back. I mean, I was in my 20s, but I had to sit back and I go, this is really strange. We've got a bunch of grown men sitting in here talking about what to name this character. And like, the things are, the suggestions are off the wall. And this meeting must have gone on for like an hour or 2 hours before somebody said Hubert. I don't know why. We had a whiteboard up in the front of the conference room. They wrote Hubert, H-U-B-E-R-T. And I was like, all right, I don't know. And then somebody was like, wait a minute, what about Q-Bert with a C, because there were cubes in the game? And it was like, okay, we might be onto something here. And then somebody said, wait, and they erased the C-U and they put a Q. And everybody's like, yeah! Everybody in the room was very excited. And everybody just knew, everybody was in agreement. Q-Bert. They had written it with a dash, and it was Jeff Lee that went and made it an asterisk. And that was it, there was. And we had a name. I got some flack about the joystick. The joystick is at a sort of an angle, and that had never been done. I mean, there were 8-way joysticks, but nobody had actually turned a 4-way joystick to be at 45-degree angles. Well, to me, it made perfect sense. In fact, it didn't make sense otherwise, because if you look at the way Q-Bert jumps, he's jumping really diagonally from a two-dimensional point of view. So, but people came up to me and they're like, you should turn the joystick. It's sideways. It shouldn't be at an angle. It should be. And I'm like, but then you can't play the game. And it really was amazing to me. But people at Gottlieb, really, a lot of them had a hard time with that. I've got this slide. Let me show you the next slide. It'll fascinate you. All right, that's my next business card. Now the difference here is that you've got the Lake Street address in North Lake. So what happened is, and this happened actually in the middle of the development of Q-Bert, we were moved from this Bensonville location into the main plant at North Lake, which meant we were merged with all of the pinball designers. Now, we had become sort of a nice tight group, and we all liked each other, we got along, and we didn't know any of the pinball designers, but we were kind of happy to join them and meet them, and a lot of us loved pinball and really admired and respected what these guys did. And our first day, mixed in with the new, with the older pinball guys, we would just be walking by and we'd find a lot of these guys are like giving us the stink eye. They're just like looking at us like, and we didn't know. Now Gottlieb didn't do any kind of introductions, they didn't do any kind of mixer, so we were just there. And it took like a couple of weeks before we sort of, broke the ice and got to know them. And we kind of realized they hated us. They resented us, because what happened was Gottlieb thought video was the new thing, The arcades were all being filled with video games, and pinball was being shoved to the side. There was a huge slump in the popularity of pinball when video games came out. So they were feeling like second-class citizens. You know, they had built this company, they had the history, and then all of a sudden they felt like these golden boys, these new guys, they're the superstars, and they were so. And of course, we didn't feel that way, and it just took a while, but it all worked itself out, and actually we came to know and respect each other. So that was a good thing. But that was a little bit of a, you know, weird befuffle. Moving on. This is the only picture that I have. It's a terrible picture, but it's the only picture I have of me developing Kubrick. There are some interesting things about this picture, blurry as it is. The blue box that you see was our development system. We called it the blue box. It had floppy disks that were about 9 inches in diameter. We wrote in assembly language. We had something like 64 kilobytes of memory to write a program in. It was ridiculous. When the first IBM PCs came out, we were able to start using those instead of this blue box, and we transitioned over. You'll see there's a cable on the bottom. That's an in-circuit emulator, an ICE, and that basically plugged into our hardware, which is what you see under the monitors, our hardware. You'll also see the little, what is actually a Tupperware bucket with the joystick mounted. It's an upside down bucket of Tupperware, and that's what the joystick was mounted on, and it's rotated 45 degrees, as you can see. Enough of that.
People come by and rotate your bucket while you weren't there?
You know, people wanted to. People really were offended somehow by that. So now I've just got a bunch of little odds and ends. This is a calendar that an artist named Chris Brewer, who actually programmed Mach 3, and he programmed another game that I'm not even sure, it might have been released, called Video Vince. He was a great artist, and he made this calendar with Kubert. Here's a page from it. And then he also made, I think it was also Chris, he made a Kubert coloring book. And again, it was a whole book with a whole lot of, this is just like one page of it. With a lot of puns. It was very punny. Here's the flyer for Kubert. Kubert went out on test. It was, you know, it collected a lot of quarters. It was very popular. Testing was a fun thing too. We would put the game out in a local arcade, and you know, kids mostly would come up and play it, and you know, I would be like lurking behind watching them. I'm surprised I didn't get arrested. But you know, that's how we would get some feedback. Just we would watch people play, and that would help us tune it. We also had focus groups. That was a little bit of a trip. So we were sitting behind, you know, one of those mirrors. And there was a guy in the other room with about, you know, 10 people, and he would talk about how, yeah, we want your opinion, blah, blah, blah. And they had a Kubert arcade game there, and they would play the game, and we would watch them play. We'd be able to see them play. And then they would ask them about it. And it was really interesting, because you'd watch these people play, and they'd be like really into it. You could see in their faces how into it they are. And then you would talk to them after, and they were like, yeah, it was okay. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. It was great. Very funny, very, very telling. This is from Glamour magazine. I mean, it's really weird to me how Kubert really got entrenched in the zeitgeist fairly quickly, but this is from August 1983. Glamour magazine is one of the least places I would have expected to see anything about Kubert. Here's a high C sweepstakes involving Kubert. There's John Cougar Mellencamp sitting there by the Kubert. It's crazy. The New Yorker. The New Yorker is talking about Kubert. This is the cover of a magazine that came out at the time. It's called Video Games Magazine. And this article was kind of interesting because of a couple of reasons. One is the article itself was about American video games versus Japanese video games, because all the, you know, Pac-Man and stuff, all the big games were really Japanese, but this particular game, these two particular games, Kubert and Joust, were American made. Joust was designed by John Newcomer, who was working at Williams at the time. And the interesting thing is that John Newcomer came to Gottlieb. So actually, John Newcomer, I met John Newcomer as a colleague at Gottlieb for a little bit before Gottlieb shut its doors. But the other interesting thing about this magazine article, is that while the people from Williams were all identified by name, those of us who worked on Kubert, namely myself, Jeff Lee, the artist, and Dave Thiel, the sound designer, we were only allowed to be referred to by pseudonyms. Gottlieb was somehow very protective of us, and they did not want our names in the article. So I am referred to as D-Zyner. Jeff was referred to as Artiste. And Dave was referred to as J. Blackman.
As long as that's there, you're good.
We're good to go. All right.
And
thank you.
And if you've ever played Kubert, you will notice that there is no credits page at the end of Kubert. You do not see our names.
Is there an end of Kubert?
No, there is not. Actually, it'll just go on. It hits a certain wall, and then it just goes on. I'll talk about that in a second. But I did, I don't know, have any of you heard of faster, harder, more challenging Kubert? Okay, so when we did that, or when I said when I did that game, I put a credits page in. So you will see our names at the end of faster, harder, more challenging Kubert. And here's just something about licensing. I've got this whole, it's a four-page thing, but they mentioned the Kubert TV series. There was a Kubert cartoon series. I don't know if you were aware, but it was kind of terrible. Did anybody watch it? Has anybody ever seen it?
I want to watch it.
You can see some episodes on YouTube. It's kind of terrible. And we had nothing to do with it. But boy, they had all sorts of stuff. I guess you can go into the exhibit hall here and you might even see some of these things. They really jumped on the merchandising, though. They really did. There were hundreds of products that that used Kubert. And I think the next thing I have, if it's not next, it's close to next, I have a very rare video of us, those of us working at Gottlieb, kind of sort of clowning around. It's horribly embarrassing. I'm going to show it to you anyway. I should personally be embarrassed. I'll sort of talk over it, and I think it's next here. Let me see.
Can we get those
So we had a cabinet that was being used. This is after the development of Mach 3. So we're developing, this is an IBM PC used for development.
Hi, folks.
This is Fred Darmstadt, one of the programmers, along with Chris Brewer of Mach 3. And apparently, we didn't have much going. I mean, we worked hard, but we also played hard. We were all complete nerds. What we did here, we were just playing around with video. So I'm holding a video camera, and he's got the Mach 3 plane up. And what you can't see that we could see is that on top of the screen is that Mach 3 plane. So everything we point the video camera on, we are seeing the Mach 3 plane overlaid over that. So he's seeing a plane over his hands.
Look out, a bird!
And then we just continue to have fun. Now, this is Joe Ulowitz. This woman, is her name was Lynn, and I can't remember her last name, the only female programmer we had there. And I'm not sure if Joe or Lynn had a game that actually made it out the door. We actually had a lot of programmers who made games that just didn't get released ever.
It's a new game.
Ah, kill me!
Kill the image on the screen.
This is Terry Torzev. Terry did the cabinet artwork and a lot of pinball back glasses. There's Jeff Lee. You can see the Kubert calendars up on somebody's cubicle. Joe Ulowitz again. I'll answer that in a second. Dave Pfeiffer did our laser disc system that was used in Mach 3.
Talking about the machine,
why are you going straight up the nostrils?
up the console. There we go. Come on.
Yeah, and you. This is me. This is why it's so embarrassing. That is my nostrils. That's Rich Tracy. Rich Tracy was the art director at Gottlieb at the time. Us versus them, we actually shot with more professional cameras. I did some home video stuff. It was a fairly bulky camera, yeah.
Space War with the evil. Look at this. It looks like giant eyeballs on this plane.
All right, and that's us having some fun. When Cubert was done, it rolled off the plant. They started making them at Gottlieb. Some people don't realize it, but Gottlieb was a manufacturing company. That's our business, was building these machines. We didn't make money off of the quarters that people put in. We sold these machines to distributors. They sold them to operators or arcade owners, and that's how it worked. This is the show, and again, sorry, it's a terrible picture, but this is a show. I believe it's the AMOA, which was one of the trade shows. There were two trade shows in the coin-op industry, and this was one of them where they had Cubert. And has anybody here been to E3? Not too many people. E3 is very similar to what these trade shows were like. Huge, pavilions with massive numbers of games. Always a party. Booth babes were very popular back in the 80s. And this is the Consumer Electronics Show where they showed the home versions of Cubert. And I'll talk about that a little bit. I mean, the home versions of Cubert were varied in quality, I thought. Of course, the arcade systems at the time had very different capabilities. Some of them were terrible, like the Atari 2600. It's really hard to do Cubert with the Atari 2600. Well, one of the reasons we were doing arcade games is we were trying to have an edge over the home systems. So it was kind of a catch-22. You're trying to do something in the arcades that you can't get from the home system, and yet, you know, if it's popular, it gets ported to the home system. My personal favorite was the ColecoVision version. I thought that was pretty true to the way Cubert looked. I remember talking to some of the developers of the Cubert home systems and giving them some advice, but I had nothing to do with them, actually. And I should also talk a little bit about the sounds of Cubert. The soundboard in Cubert had a phoneme chip, a human phoneme chip. Phonemes are basically little pieces of speech, so like buh. These are phonemes. And so it could generate these phonemes, and you could string them together to speak English, but not very well. So Dave Field, the sound designer, absolutely hated the speech that was generated by these chips. But he had this brilliant idea, and he thought, wow, wait a minute, what if we just throw out phonemes randomly? And that became Cubert's speech. There's actually only, I think, two actual English things in the entire game. When you turn the power of the cabinet on, it says, "Hello, I'm turned on." And when you're done putting your initials in the high score table, it says, "Bye-bye." Am I wrong? Does anybody know if there's another one? I don't think there's any others.
Just gibberish.
Yeah. And one question I get asked a lot is he cursing? Is he actually saying things that are curse words? And the answer is no, but he can, because it's literally random. There's, there's no filter on what he is saying or how the phonemes are being strung together. So he might have said a curse word. You might have heard that.
Do you mean it's random in the sense that it's different each time?
I mean, it's random in the sense that it is not pre-programmed. In other words, we use a random number generator and just pull a random number and say, okay, that's going to be the next phony. So it's not, it's there's nothing planned. Now, random number generators in computers, especially in our day, you started with a seed. And from that seed, the string of random numbers that you got, every time you ask for a number, the random number generator just gives you the next number in that sequence. So to get a different, if you can start with a different seed, you're going to get a different string of numbers. Many video games, though, and I believe Qbert is one of them, uses the same seed. So that's why people think there's a pattern a lot of times, because if your timing is such that you're asking for a random number at exactly the same times in different games, you're going to get the same random number each time. But if your timing is different, then, you know, you don't know whatever's next in the sequence is the one you get. Does that make sense? It's a little heady, I know. But anyway, that's the story of that. Let me see what's next here. Oh, okay. So I'm going to talk a little bit about faster, harder, more challenging Qbert and why it existed. Basically, I was being pressured, but people thought Qbert was too hard. And people would play the game in-house, and they would die, and they'd go, nobody's going to play this game. You just jump, you fall right off the pyramid, you don't know what you're doing. And so I kept making it sort of, I kept slowing it down, making it easier, and, you know, I think I made it too easy. So, you know, we put it in the arcades, and it tested really well, and people really enjoyed it. But by the time, you know, people started getting to know it, people could actually play it for hours and hours and hours. Well, we were in the, you know, we were making arcade games. The idea was to suck quarters. That was the idea. The idea was not to let you play for 3 hours on one quarter, because then the operator doesn't make money, and then the distributor doesn't buy the game. So, you know, that's just the business model. We wanted to make games that somehow were, you know, delivered just enough entertainment value that you keep putting quarters in, but we don't want to let you play forever. So Qbert, I felt, was a, you know, ended up going out the door a little too easy. So almost immediately, once it went out the door, I started retuning it. And the new tuning meant it was faster, it was harder, it was more challenging, and when they asked me what I wanted to call it, that's what I said. Because I didn't want to call it Qbert 2 or Super Qbert, and to be honest, you know, it was pretty much done. Like, people hadn't even discovered the original Qbert, and this was kind of done. So it kind of got done a little too soon, I think. And they put it out on test, also, I think, too soon, and then they just decided, you know what, we're not gonna put it out. I think they should have, like, held it for a year and then put it out, but they decided not to do that, so it was scrapped. And I was the only one who had the ROMs for it until about 1997. And in 1997, I was working at Disney Interactive, and I was working with a guy who knew the people involved in the MAME project. Is everybody familiar with MAME? It's pretty well known. You know, I told him, you know, I've got these ROMs. I mean, I was amazed at the MAME project. I just thought that was a fantastic thing. The fact that they could, you know, emulate thousands of these old arcade games and software is just amazing to me. And they really did a great job with it. So, and Qbert worked flawlessly under MAME. And faster, harder, more challenging Qbert was literally a ROM switch. It just had a, you know, there were some new graphics because there was a new character, Qbertha. And, you know, but basically it was just a ROM switch. So I said, you know, I've got the ROMs for this version of Qbert that has literally been sitting in my Qbert cabinet at home for the last, you know, 20 years, 15 years, whatever. And do you want it? Or you think they would want it? And he's like, yeah. So I said, yeah, I have it. So I just gave him those ROMs. There you go. That's it. Now all of you can play faster, harder, more challenging Qbert if you like. It's available. Anyway, this is just a page from the actual listing. The reason I can tell that this is from faster, harder, more challenging Qbert instead of regular Qbert is that there's a reference to Qbertha right in the middle of the screen. So Cube Bertha only came in with a faster armor challenge. But you could see, you know, this function, look at the top, it's called Move Chaser. Chaser is coiling. I did not name any of these characters until the end of the game. The program was all done. So all the names in here are pretty boring. Cube Bertha was the only, actually I think it's the only exception, because she was called Cube Bertha from the get-go, because we had all the other names at that point. I think this next thing is going to be moving on to another video, and then we'll talk about it afterwards, if it's what I think it is. Oh no, okay, I'm sorry, this is my third and final. There's one little other little story I'll tell you about Gottlieb. If you'll notice, this says Milestar Electronics. I don't know if you are aware, but there was a point at which Milestar, or Gottlieb, changed its name to Milestar Electronics. Some of the games actually came out with the Milestar logo as opposed to the Gottlieb logo. Why did this happen? Well, Columbia Pictures was bought by Coca-Cola. So now suddenly we were owned not by Columbia Pictures, but by Coca-Cola. I don't think Coca-Cola really liked us at all. Eventually they shut us down. In 1984, Gottlieb was shut down. We did not fail. We did not run out of money. It's not like we were not putting out good products. Coca-Cola just shut us down one day. But we were renamed Milestar, I believe, in 1983. And the fun story about this is, I remember the meeting where they called us all together and they said, all right, they literally got the entire company together, and the president of the company, his name was Boyd Brown, got up in front of everybody. Boyd Brown, by the way, was a guy we didn't see very often. And he announced the name Milestar, and they did this with a great fanfare. We're no longer going to be called Gottlieb, we're going to be called Milestar. And the first thing that occurred to me, which I said out loud, is, does anybody realize that that's rat slime spelled backwards? And they did not appreciate that. Boyd Brown especially did not appreciate that. I mean, the guys laughed, you know, all of the guys I worked with thought that was hysterical, but the management did not appreciate that. I don't know how much they paid some company to come up with this logo and this name, you know, but yeah, they weren't pleased. Anyway, in 1984, we were closed, and I moved on. Everybody did, we had to. I will say this, it was an odd place to work in those last months. Things had changed. At the very beginning, it was kind of a think tank. You know, it was like, there were no rules. We were encouraged to think out of the box. We were encouraged to create. The video game industry had not been isolated into genres at that point. So, but then what happened was, at some point, a lot of the guys, I sort of alluded to this earlier, some of the programmers, were spending like a year, 2 years on a video game and not producing it and not finishing it. And management started to say, okay, maybe this letting the programmers do whatever they want is not a good idea. I also didn't mention us versus them. I should say that, you know, the story of Qbert is great. I think the story of us versus them is a really far more interesting story. That's a whole talk in itself, and maybe I'll come back next year and tell you that story. Has everybody heard of Us Versus Them? Not too many. It's a Laserdisc game, and it came out right at the end of the Laserdisc game craze. But like I said, that's a story for another day. But what they did is they brought in a manager. His name was Bill Adams, and Bill Adams was known for a game called Spy Hunter. And I think he also programmed Tron. You know, he was a talented guy. He actually came out with a couple of games. I liked Spy Hunter and Tron. So Bill Adams came to Gottlieb as the, manager, the guy to sort of crack the whip and get things going into shape. Well, Bill had some philosophies about video game design. No video game should take more than 4 months to make. Now, at the time, that really wasn't an unreasonable thing. I mean, honestly, Qbert probably took me 4, maybe 5 months. But he had this thing, 4 months, that's it. If it takes more than 4 months, scrap it. And so he cracked the whip, and a lot of the guys at Gottlieb did not really appreciate or enjoy that. And I don't know if that had anything to do with, you know, the closing of Milestar, but that was just something. When it did close, it wasn't quite as terrible as maybe some of us would have thought. I mean, I thought I would work there for the rest of my life, but towards the end, it was like, yeah, maybe it is time to move on. And I did. I moved on to another company that had nothing to do with video games, and I was there for about a year. And then I got a call from Williams Bally Midway. And Williams Bally Midway just were hiring, and they were just sort of like, hey, are you interested? And I was. Of course, I was itching to get back into video games. So I was very excited to go there. And of course, Williams Bally Midway at that time had done Defender, Stargate, Robotron. So now, if you look at Defender, Stargate, Robotron, and you look at Qbert, and Us Versus Them, you know, Us Versus Them had some shooting in it, but, you know, it was whimsical. It wasn't really high testosterone. You know, I don't really seem like a really good fit for Williams. I'm not that guy. I'm not the Defender guy, you know? But I thought, okay, well, I can do my kind of games there. I didn't really ever have an opportunity to do my kind of games there, although I did have an opportunity to do some really fascinating stuff. And the thing that I was most proud of during my Williams years was video digitizing, which didn't exist when I first started. We all, plopping pixels in a little 16 by 16 pixel grid, we all dreamed of a day where you're going to do movie quality graphics. I mean, we all knew we were going there. We just didn't, you know, the hardware wasn't there, the tools weren't there. We literally were plopping individual pixels. In fact, I think one of my first projects at Williams was to write a system, a little art system to plop pixels in a grid. The first game I did at Williams was Joust 2, which was, nice. Joust was a huge hit. I came onto the project late. It was one of those projects where the original programmer failed. The original programmer, you know, was not competent. And so they brought me and somebody else in to sort of fix it at the last minute. But it was a great project. I'm very proud of it. And John Newcomer was still involved as a designer at that point, having been laid off from Gottlieb, having left Williams and then been laid to go to Gottlieb, then laid off from Gottlieb. He's back at Williams. Where was I? Wow, isn't that bad? So Joust 2 came out, that was great. But then I was really enamored of this video digitizing, and something came out for the Amiga hardware. Is everybody, the Amiga was a sort of Amiga fans. A company called A-Squared came out with a video digitizer for the Amiga that worked off of a three-color wheel. So here's what you did. You had a little, kind of a little boxy, it looks like a security camera, black and white video camera that you would put on a tripod and point at something, and then you, in front of it, you'd put this three-color wheel, red, green, and blue filters. And I think the three-color wheel thing was on a motor, and it would just rotate. So it spent about 10 seconds on red, 10 seconds on green, 10 seconds on blue, and then it would merge those three into a full-color image. That's 30 seconds to get one single digitized frame. Not very practical, but it got me started in learning about digitizing. And then not too long after that, a company called True Vision came out with the Targa board. You probably have all heard of Targa as a file format, right? You can save files as a TGA file. Well, where did that format come from? It came from True Vision. And they came out with this thing called a Targa board. And the Targa board had this capability. They actually came out with a series of boards. One was called the ICB, one was called the VDA. The VDA used 8-bit indexed color, so you had a color table. But the Targa board was true color, meaning you had 16 bits per pixel. 5 bits red, 5 bits green, 5 bits blue, and then the other bit was something else. And they also, this is what was cool about the Targa board, they had a software developing kit, an SDK. So I could write my own software to control the Targa board. And that's where things really, really took off with video digitizing. So the first, and I basically created this, oh, sure.
I don't mean to interrupt.
No, please.
I'm just interested to know, when you switched from Gottlieb to Williams, mm-hmm. were you hired in as just like another programmer, or were you relatively like famous, like, oh, this is the guy who came up with Hubert, we're getting him on board?
Like a little of both. I wouldn't say I was famous, because I don't think Hubert was that well respected at Williams. Like I said, you know, Hubert was a little bit of a trifle game. It wasn't the guys at Williams were like high testosterone. They were into that kind of stuff. I mean, Hubert was successful. Nobody could argue with that. And I think that definitely worked in my favor. So they were happy to get the guy who did Hubert. But I don't think, I was certainly not exalted. I was just another one of the guys.
Oh, okay. They didn't like try and wine and dine you in, like, you know.
Not really. And I will say that the golden child at Williams was Eugene Jarvis. When I was hired, Eugene had left Williams. He did Stargate Defender Robotron, him and Larry DeMar. And they left to form their own company called VidKids. And they were developing games sort of for Williams, but apart from Williams. And then he went and got an MBA in California. So Eugene was sort of out of the picture when I got hired. And actually, this is sort of part of the story, so I'll just keep going. But Mark Lofredo is the hardware designer. And, you know, once this digitized, so I got this digitizing going, and we were all seeing the writing on the wall, is that, you know, we're going to be capable of movie quality graphics very soon. So we started thinking about hardware systems that will allow 256 colors. Every video game system was pretty much 16 colors up until that point. But, you know, the home games were getting better, and we were on the, you know, we needed to have an edge in the arcade, so we thought 256 colors, that allows you to get very close to, you couldn't get true color, it would be close. So, Mark Lofredo came up with this idea for a hardware system that would have different planes. It was kind of a rack system, so you'd slide a board in, and every board you could slid in was a different plane. So you could do, you know, sort of like multi-planar, like if any of you know about Disney and multi-planar animation, we would be able to do stuff like that with our games. Well, during the development of that, Eugene was enticed to come back after he got his MBA, and he scrapped that entire project. He's like, yeah, no. Because Eugene was the golden child. He really was at Williams. Steve Ritchie was the golden child for pinball, and Eugene was the golden child for video. And he basically, Eugene headed up the video department when he came back. And he had this other idea for a 256 color system that was more traditional, foreground, background, and it would use a DMA, which is something that Williams used on their earlier systems, to just do very fast transfer of images onto the screen. So we proceeded with that, and then we divided up the work. Eugene wrote the operating system for this new hardware. I wrote the display system for the new hardware. And the first games that came out on that new hardware were, well, the first game, I should say, was NARC. And NARC used digitized graphics. But there's a story behind that. While NARC was being developed by Eugene and Jack Hager, who was the lead artist, I was working with John Newcomer on a rival game. And, you know, Williams was competitive. You know what I mean? Again, high testosterone. I'm not that much of a competitive guy. I'm a cooperative guy. I like to, we're all on a team here. We're all the same family. But you know, Williams was kind of like, I want to beat you. I want to be there first. I want to be better. So they had that going on. And basically, we were pitted by management against each other. So Eugene was working, once the hardware and operating and display systems were all developed, Eugene and Jack Hager were working on NARC, and John and I were working on a tank game called USSA. And basically it was, the idea was that, you know, Russia, because, you know, of course they were our big enemies, we were fighting the Russians on our turf. And basically this was a sort of an update of the old tank game. So you have a top-down view, and you're looking at tanks going, you know, going through streets, which form sort of something of a maze. And the player is driving a 4x4 truck with a rocket launcher in the bed of the truck. And you can launch rockets, so you're driving, right? And you launch rockets out of the bed, and then you can steer the rocket with a steering wheel. And this was a game where two players played side by side, and they each had their own scrolling version of the world, so they could be in different places in the world. We love this game. I mean, we, you know, the other thing is that it used completely video digitized graphics. John Newcomer was buying up these models. I don't even know where he got them. Houses, 7-Elevens, McDonald's, to make this neighborhood look, you know, very much digitized. He digitized grass. He digitized roads. Everything looked photorealistic. It looked phenomenal. And we thought we had a great game. But there was a big trade show coming up, and they could only pick one game to go. And not to my or anybody else's surprise, they picked Eugene's game. I mean, there was no way they were going to pick our game over Eugene's. Now, NARC, you know, was a great game. Don't get me wrong. I had a little bit of a problem with the exploding body parts, because the fact, you know, it's like Jeff Goldblum says in Jurassic Park, just because you could do something doesn't mean you should. So, you know, we were working with, you know, digitized graphics, really, for the first time, although they were very cleaned up. They were cleaned, they were, the artists cleaned up that digitized stuff very much so. But still, it looked pretty good. I don't know if anybody, does anybody remember NARC? Anybody ever play NARC? So, you know, there's like a guy in a trench coat who's hunched over, you know that guy? That's Mark Lafredo. He's the hardware designer. A lot of times we put ourselves in the games. Video digitized, all right, so enough of that. I actually, make a long story short, I left Williams because after USSA got scrapped, and I wasn't too pissed off about that. The question was, what are we gonna do next? And they asked me if I wanted to do a football game, which really kind of made sense. A football game, I even recognized, was a perfect thing for digitized graphics, to bring this level of new graphics to a sports themed game. But I had no interest in doing a football game. I wasn't a football fan. It just, I didn't relish the thought of working on that. And I said, yeah, I'm not interested, but thanks anyway. I'll figure out what I'll do next. And then I was called into a meeting with Ken Fidesna, who was the vice president of engineering at Williams. And he said, so, did Eugene tell you you're working on the football game? I was like, no. He asked me, but he didn't tell me. And I ended up quitting. So I left Williams. And I won't get into too much detail, but during that period, I went to a company called Pixel Lab, who was working with Premier Technology, which was the remnants of Gottlieb. So what happened was, when Gottlieb was closed, all of the pinball, well, actually, I think it was one vice president named Gil Pollack. He bought the rights to use the Gottlieb name, and he hired up all the pinball designers, and he opened up his own company to continue making Gottlieb pinball games. They called themselves Premier Technologies. They had been doing that for a few years, and they wanted to do video games. So they called on me, and they hired me as a consultant. And that's a whole long story that I won't tell right now. But I sort of worked for them for about 3 or 4 years, and then I was invited back to Williams. Williams called me in 1991 because a programmer had left in the middle of the Terminator 2 project. They were doing a game based on the movie Terminator 2. And they asked me if I wanted to come back. And the timing was absolutely perfect. I said, yes, I would love to come back. So I came back and joined the Terminator 2 team, which was headed up by Jack Hager as the lead artist, and George Petro, who was a young, young kid. He was like working at Williams when he was 17 years old. And he was probably, you know, in his early 20s at this point. And he was the lead programmer. And I came in as sort of a senior programmer. So I worked on that. And just to get back to video digitizing. So again, they had been using my video digitizing system all that time I was gone. But it was so crude. It was, I mean, I couldn't believe it. But what they would have to do is, they would videotape what they wanted to use, and then they would have to freeze frame, grab a frame, clean it up, clean out the background, and I thought, oh my God, you know, in 4 years, the hardware had gotten so much better and faster. So one of the things I did is start to improve that. And I got to the point where we actually had a video digitization system where we could point, we actually made a blue screen studio at Williams. We had a nice video camera, we pointed at the subject, and we could digitize probably 5 or 10 seconds of motion and have it transferred into our hardware, you know, within a minute. And that's where we actually had some. And it got used for, Mortal Kombat, you know. The original Mortal Kombat using like a really old version of the digitizer, but as each Mortal Kombat came out, it got better and better. NBA Jam Tournament Editions, Hit the Ice, I think, you know, a lot, any of Williams games that came out started having digitized graphics on. The next thing I'm going to show you a little video, which is a promo. It's actually edited down. It's less than 2 minutes. But it's a promo for Revolution X. Is everybody familiar with Revolution X? Featuring Aerosmith. There's a little behind the scenes stuff here.
Can you go up and volume a little?
Saw, of course, the blue screen studio we had set up. There was one shot where you saw a treadmill. We actually had a treadmill where we took the top off so we could, and we would turn that treadmill in one of eight directions, so we can get multi-directional. We could have people turning, get walking cycles and running cycles in all directions. We had Aerosmith for 3 days, three like 13-hour days. And then I think a week later, a couple of the guys, the Tom Hamilton and one of the other guys, came for a day for pickup stuff. But these guys were amazing. They were great. They were game to do whatever we needed. Anything we asked, they would do. And, I'll be the first to tell you, the game, I didn't think was that great. Now, Revolution X, I don't think it was that great of a game. There were great things in it, and there were things in it that I was really proud of, but the whole package somehow I felt didn't come together. Anyway, I don't know if you noticed me in that video. I was the guy with the clipboard. That was my job during the shoot. I was the clipboard guy, or the clapboard. And you also saw a shot of WTAR. There was a screen where you saw little numbers, and that was actually my program that we used to grab and digitize. There's another thing you saw in there. You know, I talked about how we all put ourselves in the game. You saw a shot in there where you kind of go through these doors and there's a guy sitting behind a desk. That was me. That was my appearance in Revolution X. And that was part, it was a thing that I programmed. I'm actually very, very proud of that one little section of the game because basically, you can't kill me. You know, you come in through the doors and I duck down behind that desk and I start lobbing grenades at you and you cannot shoot me. The way you have to get rid of me. Has anybody played Revolution X? You shoot, there's a sign above me that says Evergreen Chemical, and it's held on by like a couple of chains. You have to shoot the chains, and the sign falls on me, and I die. And that's, you know, so that's the kind of element that I like in a game, like a little bit of a puzzle element where you have to think about what you're doing, do something maybe out of the ordinary. All of the Aerosmith guys were hidden in the game. So you know, sometimes you had to go off the beaten track to find them. Maybe it was a little too obscure, I'm not sure. But I have to say it was an amazing experience to have these guys and to put stuff like this together. The other thing about, I'll say about Revolution X was I wrote the display system, and I was very proud of that too. It was sort of a pseudo 3D, so you could move forward, backward, and side scroll, even though it was not a true 3D game. So you get the illusion. It worked very well. I'm getting close to the end. I'm just going to ask: are there any questions about anything you want to ask?
Who owns the copyright to what's it? Faster, harder, more challenging, Qbert?
That would be Sony. Sony owns all of the rights to Qbert.
So when I download it in my MAME at home, that's who I should send my check to.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you could send it to me. I'll happily take the measures. technically Sony, because Sony, so Coca-Cola bought Columbia Pictures, but then Coca-Cola sold Columbia Pictures to Sony, and so now Sony owns the rights to Qbert.
Was it your idea to put the knocker in the bottom of Qbert?
No, actually, I'll tell you the story about the knocker. So the knocker was the idea of a guy named Rick Tai, who was a technician that worked for us. And you know, so we had the game where Qbert would jump off and plummet, and he said, you know, it'd be really cool if you could, you know, we could put a pinball knocker down on the bottom of the cabin, you can hear a knock. And we did that, and it sounded like this. And I thought, well, Qbert's not going to make that sound. Qbert's not a rock. We need something that sounds like squishy, like a thud. It needs to be something, you know, it sounds like it has to sound like a body, right? Well, so we came up with a solution where we took a little piece of foam, and the way a knocker works, it's just got this kind of like wire that it whips against the cabinet. We put a piece of foam where it makes contact, and it made the perfect sound. I mean, it sounded freaking awesome. It was like a body landed at the bottom of the cabinet. And then in manufacturing, they said, you know what, it's too labor intensive. We can't do it. So that was scrapped. They put the knocker in. Everybody loves the knocker sound, and I'm like the only one who laments the fact that it's not as cool as it could have been. Any other questions?
Jobs too. Why the vertical orientation? It just never made much sense.
It's a really, really horrible yet simple answer. Jobs 2 is intended as a kit to go into existing cabinets. And their research showed that there were more vertical cabinets than horizontal cabinets. Yeah, terrible game design decision. It was completely a practical business decision. And that was sort of like the given. It was like, you're gonna do Jaws 2, you gotta make it vertical. Anything else?
Yeah. When you took the job to make video games, what were your personal favorite video games at that time?
That's a good question. Wow, let's see. I liked Time Pilot. I liked Berserk. I'm trying to think of what else I liked. I think those were kind of the ones that were out in that, you know, right when I started. I mean, earlier I liked any kind of a tank game. I always loved tank games. You know, the top down. But those were probably the ones I liked the most.
Regarding digitizing, when you did the players in NBA Jam, did you have to have all the players that were in that game, or use pictures?
I think we used pictures. I think they used pictures. I could be wrong. I mean, it could, you know, that's a good question. I did not program that game, so I'm not sure entirely, but it is very, because we needed 8 directions, you know, and it is possible that somebody went out and digitized those actual players. You know, the guys from Williams were all in that game too, so you can play as me. If you put in my initials, my birthday, you can actually play with my name and my head. But when we did Terminator 2, we actually sent somebody out with a video camera, and they videoed all of the actual sets from the movie. And we had some of the actors. So we actually, they didn't come to our studio, but out in California, somebody, I don't know who it was, went and digitized Robert Patrick and Eddie Furlong. We didn't get Linda Hamilton, we got her stunt double. And we didn't get Arnold Schwarzenegger, but we got his stunt double in an Arnold mask. But we did get to, you know, video a lot of the Terminator models and things, and so all of the stuff in the movie is really authentic.
So when Qbert first came out as an arcade, was there any, like, grand opening where the arcade was first at, and having public play it?
You mean where the first Qbert cabinet was? Well, I mean, it went out on test. So there was a place called Mother's that was out in the suburbs of Chicago, and we put a lot of our games out on test. So before these were like engineering samples. They weren't actual, production games. But we, and there were a variety of arcades that we would put, our games out just to test it, because again, we want them to watch people play, get feedback. I don't think they're, and then they rolled off the production line, to be honest. I don't know where they went. They just got shipped off to people and they were all over the place, yeah.
For Hubert, did you consider other playfield shapes other than a pyramid?
The question is, did I consider other playfield shapes, Hubert? And the answer is no. Because again, it came out of this notion of randomness, that every time you land, you have a choice of one or two paths to go. So every time a ball drops, there's one byte of data, which is 8 bits. So I have 7 bits to choose from. And that determines the path of the ball from start to finish. Of course, when you get to the characters, they're like Coily has an algorithm to follow Hubert. But the other characters, if their path is predetermined, it was all random. So having different playfield shapes would have thrown all that off. And again, at the time, certainly future versions of Hubert did do things like that, and that's great because it's an extension. But at the time, we didn't know if the original Hubert was even going to be liked. So, yeah.
Was it your intention to be able to jump over Coily? Because there have been a couple instances where I've actually glitched through the snake.
No, that's a bug.
Okay.
I'd say that is definitely a bug. it's hard to write a piece of software without a bug, I would say. Yeah.
Oh, as Max, what are you doing these days, if you're not in the games industry, what inspired you to jump out of that?
I'm more of an actor and a stage director these days. I work in Los Angeles, and I'm not really in the games industry, although I still do software consulting. And just for myself, for fun, I'm kind of delving into Android programming. So I'm sort of teaching myself that, and I have some ideas for Android games that I'd actually like to start developing on my own. Mostly I'm an actor and a director these days and enjoying that tremendously. I started doing that in college, never intending it to be a career. And I was doing stage plays all throughout my time doing video games. The entire time I was making video games, I was doing theater in the evenings and short films or commercials or whatever, all of that time. But I never did it as a career. I just did it for fun. And then what happened was all the people around me that I was doing it with, we all just sort of moving up the ladder kind of and working in bigger theaters and getting bigger jobs. And then suddenly I was a professional actor and I really didn't intend that.
Have you seen Moscow on the Hudson?
I have, that's right. It's one of the
Hubert scene in there.
It's very keep in mind, Moscow on the Hudson was a Columbia picture.
Okay.
So it's a little bit of product placement for Columbia Pictures to put that in there. But I was told, whether it's true or not, I have no idea. I was told that Robin Williams was a fan of Hubert. And he loved it. He loved the sounds. He loved to make those sounds in the game all over the place. Did you have something?
Oh, did your top-down tank game ever go anywhere? Did it survive?
No, it was developed. I'd say it was like 75% of the way developed, this is something I didn't understand. It was the same with faster, harder, more challenging Hubert. Why not hold it until the market is ready for it?
Right.
But for some reason, they could not, wrap their brains around that. So there were two games being developed, and they knew they only had floor space at the big convention for one game, where they wanted to both just put all the focus on one game so as not to have two games competing against each other in the marketplace. I'm just guessing here, because it doesn't really make any sense to me. But they did not proceed with it.
A lot of the console game developers talk about programming with the constraints of the hardware. How much say as a game designer for a coin-op do you have over the specs of the hardware?
Really not very much. Generally, in the arcade world, it certainly at Gottlieb, all of the arcade system was done. It was built. It's like, make a game that you can build on this hardware. At Williams, I would say, Eugene had some influence. If Eugene said, we need to change the hardware so we can do this cool thing, they would change the hardware. But that was pretty unusual, I'd say. Something in the back? Yeah.
Yeah, the curse bubble for Hubert has probably inspired tons of game sets, but what inspired you to add the curse bubble to Hubert?
Well, you know, it was just a sense of fun. You know, I have a sense of humor. I didn't want to take a game too seriously. You know, there was a thing I've been telling people for years, which is, you know, half true. As I said, you know, the reason you play Q-Bert, the reason Q-Bert has a joystick and no other controls is because I want them to be able to play it with one hand while I'm holding a drink. That's actually half true. You know, I mean, I say it glibly and it's a joke, but, you know, I wanted something simple and fun. That was, for me, you know, Q-Bert was just something fun. I didn't want a game that you took too seriously, and that just sort of fell right into it. Anything else?
Is there anywhere we can find a ROM of that USSA?
If there is, I don't know where it is. Yeah. And you know, it's really weird. Things crop up on the internet all the time that just surprise the heck out of me. Like if you go to YouTube, you can find like the entire video of this behind the scenes with Aerosmith. You can, you know, this is a promo, and I actually cut this down from like a 6-minute promo. But you can find not the promo, but just the actual footage. And it's pretty amazing to watch these days. By the way, if you notice, there was a gorgeous girl in a bikini. Her name is Carrie Hoskins, and man, everybody at Williams loved her, obviously. But she was in so many games. She was also the dark-haired woman that you saw very briefly in Revolution X. She was the original, not the original maybe. She was Sonya Blade in some versions of Mortal Kombat. You know, every opportunity these guys had to put her in a game, they did. She's like a story to itself. Yeah?
Do you still have the source code that you wrote, or is that something that the company just had?
I have printouts of Q-Bert, Faster, Harder, More Challenging Q-Bert, and Us Versus Them. They're thick. And of course, you know, it was assembler language, so, you know, we're writing in something that was very close to the binary that you see in the ROMs. Yeah. Anything else? Awesome. Perfect timing. Thank you so much. I really appreciate you guys coming out.